Good evening, everyone. My name is Donna Heilman, and I'm the mayor pro tem of the city of West Hollywood. I want to welcome you to our Human Rights Speaker Series event. We have been doing events in the city of West Hollywood for some time. We've focused on a number of different issues, but because this is Gay and Lesbian Pride Month, LGBT Pride Month in the city of West Hollywood, we'd like to focus on LGBT equality, and particularly we like to focus on the challenges of achieving equality internationally. Now, of course, we had a very traumatic incident, a tragic incident that occurred, and that has spurred a lot of talk about LGBT equality, and it certainly has spurred some discussion about LGBT equality in other parts of the world. So we're really delighted that we have a number of interesting speakers here who are working on issues, particularly in China, but Bob is here, who's been working on issues globally for many years. Let me start by first introducing our panelists, and then we're gonna take a moment of silence for the victims of the Orlando tragedy. Bob Alotta is the executive director of the Astraea Foundation. It's the Astraea Lesbian Foundation, and Bob has been a panelist here in the city of West Hollywood before. It is a global foundation dedicated to LGBT equality. Bob is an accomplished filmmaker as well as a lifelong activist. And Astraea builds partnerships with organizations throughout the world. Astraea helps organizations, particularly lesbian and transgender groups in different parts of the world, helps them achieve or strive for equality. And the work that Astraea is doing is really instrumental in changing minds and in protecting people in many parts of the world from enforced violence and discrimination. Mulan Wu is the director of the Shenyang Lesbian Fraternity. The organization was founded by local lesbians in Shenyang. It provides services and support to lesbians living in northeastern areas of China, and the organization serves as a platform for the community to communicate, to entertain, and to certainly advocate, and the advocacy is towards equality for the LGBT community. Rain Gao is the director for the Anhui Hefei Youth Health Service Center. I'm sure I'm mispronouncing some of that. It is a community-based LGBT organization established in August 2005, and it's devoted itself to HIV and AIDS prevention and control, specifically targeting gay and bisexual men. Currently, Rain leads three projects concentrating on HIV prevention and testing, and the organization also has launched an LGBT cultural activity titled Youth Rainbow Series. Joe has been one of our panelists before. Joe began working as a gay activist at the age of 16, and he has served in many capacities, including the executive director of the Beijing Zhu Yao Information and Consulting Center and the Beijing LGBT Center. He's was the project director of the Shihang Foundation MSM project, and he has been really active in so many areas of rights. He is a board member of the China Sex Worker Forum, and during the past year, he led a group of volunteers to collect and categorize data of LGBT-related cases in the Chinese court system. All of our representatives here from China are part of a program that the Los Angeles Gay and Lesbian Center has, where they host activists from China and collaborate with them and partner with them, and also do training on how to advocate for LGBT rights.
and all three of them just came back from AIDS life cycle. So thank you for doing that as well. And our final panelist, who we've labeled interpreter, but he's so much more than that, is Damien Liu. Damien Liu is a PhD from UCLA. He works at the LA County Department of Mental Health. He has been working with Asian LGBT people since the 1980s. He joined the newly founded ABI website in 1998 and has been providing just an amazing amount of information to Chinese-speaking people around the world. He has been an advisor to the HIV/AIDS project of several trusts. He has worked as a consultant to HIV/AIDS prevention and care program in Sichuan province in 2007. His resume and expertise goes back a long way. And he has been working with the center here in Los Angeles since 2008 as this partnership. They have trained over 50 activists from China who are working back in China on LGBT issues. So please join me in welcoming all of our panelists tonight. And before we get started, I do want to ask for your cooperation and patience. We do have an interpreter up here that sometimes slows the panel a little bit, but we are so fortunate to have these panelists, and we want to make sure that they're understanding our questions well and that their answers are being provided accurately to the public. Before we get started, though, we all know of the tragic events in Orlando, and I think it's appropriate, given tonight's topic, for us to start with a moment of silence in recognition of the loss of life in Orlando. Thank you. We are going to, that is going to be a part of our conversation tonight, but before we get into that topic, I'm going to ask each of our panelists to tell us a little bit about the work that they're doing, some of the highlights of what they're doing, and the real challenges they're facing right now. I'm going to ask everyone to keep their remarks brief so we can get into some of the questions that the audience may have as well. So Bob, tell us a little bit more about what Astraea is doing right now. You're all around the world and the challenges you're facing.
Sure, thank you. Thank you for having me, and it's really lovely to be here with all of you.
Move it really close.
Okay. I might burst into song though, so just
that's
beware.
Okay.
Yeah,
song is good.
Okay, so as John said, Astraea is has next year will be our 40th anniversary. So for the last 40 years, Astraea has been funding LGBTQI activists around the world. We have funded in over 90 countries and 48 states, which is nearly half the world. And we prioritize the leadership of lesbians, trans people, people of color. We are a public foundation, which means we raise all of the money that we grant, and we really take our role as a public foundation seriously. And so we also see our job as really connecting the dots and connecting stakeholders. So whether it's an individual donor who gives us $5 a month or a government that gives us $1 million, we really very purposefully set the table both politically and socially for an exchange and participation. And that's really super important to us. In terms of challenges, I think it's an interesting moment because in the United States, there are some folks, and I think maybe this week, some minds have been changed, but there are some folks who thought, oh, the work is over, despite the fact that gender nonconforming queer people are being routinely murdered in this country, that people of color are being routinely murdered in this country, that healthcare, access to education and wealth and viable services are all LGBTQ issues, none of which get resolved with the legalization of marriage. And so I think we find ourselves in an interesting moment now on the heels of such a violent incident to really ask ourselves what are the conditions that allow for that kind of violence to occur, why that kind of violence would occur. And those are the same questions we ask in all of the countries where we work. And I think that there's a sensibility that that's a problem that's happening over there. And unfortunately, that's not the case. And I think we work really hard at Astraea to position the United States as part of the world, and that the conditions that queer people face globally, while they are nuanced, and certainly they are relative to the cultures inside of which we're living in each of our towns, let alone countries. And those are real and should be acknowledged. I think we operate from a place of really privileging the cultural truths anyone is living inside of. That's super important to us. But I think when we are talking, there are lessons that can be learned from our community everywhere in terms of what is our lived experience in alongside of our legal experience in all of those countries, and the United States is no exception, unfortunately. So I think our biggest challenge is A, being able to effectively tell that story, and also constantly looking for the resources to resource grassroots activism on the ground everywhere we work.
That's great, thank you. Mulan, I think this is the first time we've had a lesbian organization represented as part of the China contingent. So thank you so much for being here. Tell us about the work you're doing and the challenges that you are facing.
Okay. Go ahead. Our work, I want to share a small story first. It's our service. Several months ago, a lesbian, she contacted me on the internet for help. She's a lesbian, she's 24 years old, and she lives in Shenyang, our city, our organization. This city is the biggest city of Northeast China. Northeast China is a very big region. And she came out, that was her holiday for the Spring Festival of China. And she stayed at home. She came out for her parents. And her mother was very angry. Her mother was a Christian. And she let her to change to be straight. Her mother said that will not be fine, and you must be straight. You won't marry with a girl or whatever. And the worst thing is her mother keep her in home, don't let her go out, and let her have traditional Chinese medicine every day to make her change her sexual orientation. And she didn't know what she have. She didn't know what she had every day, but she have no. She had no choice. And she couldn't get out of home. And she contacted with me on the internet. She wanted. She asked me some documents, some stories, or some professional who can tell her mother she is normal, she's not, that this is not sick, but her mother didn't change her mind. Because she's a traditional, maybe because she's a Christian. And the situation keep like this for a week. And I don't know how to solve this problem because in China, the policeman couldn't enter in the family problem. So she keeps to have medicine every day, and she couldn't come out. And after a week, I asked her, did your mother change her mind? She told me, I don't need to take the medicine now, because my mother found a fortune teller, and the fortune teller told her, your girl will be fine in the future, and she will be straight one day. And then she mother believed him, and she mother believed that her daughter will be fine, will be a straight girl, and that she won't love a girl anymore. But this problem is not solved completely. Her mother still don't accept her orientation. But she got her freedom, and now she moved to another city for work. But the way to come out is still long. That's a small story I want to share. So in our region, I think because in China the movement of LGBT is just started, not long, and the change and the development of work changed very fast, I think. Compared to other countries, we changed very fast because with the problem of religion is not so huge, it's not so... most Chinese don't have a religion. So when we tell him some knowledge or something about LGBT, when we talked enough about some people they can accept, we found that. So I think that's one reason that we developed well.
That's great. And it sounds like some of the issues that you face are issues that we face in this country and particular regions, and with parents who have traditional or religious upbringing, the problem of acceptance, the problem of information. We've had the same issue in this country with parents trying to send their children to reparative therapy to try to cure the gayness out of them. So it sounds like you're facing some of the same challenges we've faced here. Rain, why don't we turn to you? Tell us a little bit about the work you're doing with the Anhui Hefei Youth Health Service Center. I can't say all of that. Tell us a little bit about your work and the challenges you're facing.
I didn't understand the last.
挑战是，Damien，你要用，你们，我刚才我问你们，要不要用中文讲？你要用中文讲也可以。他问你挑战，就是你在现在在做的事情和面对的挑战有哪些？Sorry,
maybe as in order to understand better, I think Chinese. I think I wanted to speak Chinese, and we have a good translator. 就是关于工作的一个挑战，因为我们已经做了有一个，就是实际上有一个十几年的时间，然后呢，那么现在进入了一个，在我们觉得是一个，就是说工作不知道该往哪儿走的一个问题。
So our organization has been in existence for over 10 years, and we are, speaking of challenges, we are facing some soul search. We're wondering where we're going next. Because our organization was founded to be a health or gay men's health organization, what we found was more we focused on the disease itself, it's spreading more.
尽管政府他投入了很多的经费，我们社会组织也做了很多的工作，但是呢，在我们这样一个背景下，我们所采取的措施，我们所采取措施，它的收效其实是比较有限的。
Even though both the government and civil society have put into put in a lot of resources to fight the disease, but under the social condition, when all the discrimination exists, these efforts have not been effective.
有许多的青年人，当他刚刚进入学校的时候，他甚至不了解什么是同性恋，什么是艾滋病，但他可能就会已经感染了。So
some young people, as they enter college, they still are not truly clear about sexuality or about their own sexuality, but they're infected already.
因为他没有这样一个好的一个环境，让他去了解自身。
Because there's no, there isn't the social support and community support to help them deal with their own issues first.
就拿我自己来说，我可能在我大概十一二岁的时候，我就知道我是一个同性恋，但是确实在我二十多岁的时候，我才知道有艾滋病这回事儿。For
example, myself, I knew I was gay when I was about 11 years old, but I only learned about HIV/AIDS when I was 20.
因为我们不知道该找谁去谈，因为我们在平常的一个社会的，这样一个日常的一个文化的交流中，我们是很难去，特别作为年轻人，我们很难去，就是说有一个好的环境让我们去讨论，然后让我们去接受到充分的信息。Because
we have no one to turn to or a place to turn to obtain information or to talk about these issues safely. Not at home, not at school, not in most social conditions.
所以现在对我们来说，我们的工作一个很大的挑战就是我们怎样去使这些年轻人，在他们还没有，就是还没有去感染之前，然后呢，去怎样去让他更好的去了解知识。So
our challenge really is to reach them early enough, so that they have their armed with knowledge before they get infected.
我们越来越感觉到，改变我们的文，使我们的文化更加的包容，是非常重要的。So
more and more we understand that HIV/AIDS, fighting HIV/AIDS could not be in a vacuum. It must be combined with the improvement of social acceptance and cultural understanding.
只有当学校能够允许 同性恋去活动，然后去能够去充分的去讲同性恋这个事情的时候，我们才能够去从根本上去做更好的做艾滋病的工作。Until
the day where schools, universities can allow NGOs to come in to talk about sexuality and homosexuality openly, we don't think we're going to make a lot of progress on the fight against HIV/AIDS.
但这一点在我们所在的城市还不能做到。
But this is, at least in the city that I'm in, he's from a second-tier city, it's still very difficult. Most schools resist. Because I came from an underdeveloped area of China. The local officials, the school officials are still very conservative, and they're not open to us talking to the students directly about these issues.
包括一些大学的教授，他甚至认为，你如果去，你是一个同性恋，你如果去学校里面去讲同性恋的话，那么你会把那些异性恋给变成同性恋。
Some school teachers, including our own professors, still believe that if you have gays coming to school to talk, you're going to produce more gays.
Again, this sounds very familiar to us because we've gone through those same battles, and obviously you can't fight the spread of HIV unless you also deal with the underlying discrimination and access to information. All of that needs to be looked at holistically. So thank you for the work that you're doing. Joe, you've really been focusing recently on the legal status of LGBT people and looking at court cases involving the rights of LGBT people. Tell us a little bit more about the work you're doing and some of the challenges you're facing. So the overall LGBT movement in China has developed into a stage where some organizations
are experimenting with using the legal system to fight for rights of LGBT people.
但是因为在国内的话，其实没有更多的一些人有经验，所以呢，其实我们因为中国是不是一个就是法治国家，因为它其实在很多的这种法治的一些体系上其实跟美国是不太一样的，所以其实在这种体系下，其实很多的国内在去做一些法律的事情的时候是非常难的，再加上其实我们没有很多的经验，那这个时候呢，其实我们更多的其实是在借鉴一些可能台湾、香港，包括可能西方的一些这种法律的一些经验。
And the two major challenges that these experiments are facing, one is, of course, the difference in legal systems and the legal philosophy. The Chinese judiciary is not completely independent. And the second is a lack of experience to bring suits against parties that discriminate. For example, there is no precedence in China. Not only within the LGBT arena, there's very little of that in any other human rights arena.
但是其实我们在去通过法律去做一些就是一些方法的时候，我们会发现其实更多的还是用倡导的方式来去做，但其实并没有我们去考虑的更深的，其实是说我们要通过法律来去达到什么样的一个目的，而是说我只是把它引起了一种社会的一个影响力，但是其实在这个后续的话，我们是完全没有跟进的。
So the four or five cases that happened in the last couple of years geared toward more public awareness and public news making. They clearly did grab some media attention, but there was very little forethought and planning and virtually no follow-up.
所以我们在国内很多目前在做的一些跟法律有关的一些策略性的倡导的话，其实更多的是关注于在于个案的部分。那其实有一个很好的例子，就是因为我们之前有一场官司是针对于扭转治疗的一个案件。那其实虽然我们通过那场官司那个个案的话，就是我们是赢了的，对于那个就是心理治疗诊所是赢了的，但是其实现在的话，我们会发现其实在那个心理诊所它并没有去被关闭和被有相应的惩罚，反而它现在对于扭转治疗的部分它反而是涨价了。
The first case was brought against a clinic, a mental health clinic that claims to provide reparative therapy. And that was a very good example. The LGBT side won the case and there was a court judgment. However, this clinic not only is continuing to practice, it has raised its price since.
所以我们现在其实就希望说能够去找一些在国内已经有过一些相关 LGBT 经验的一些律师，那其实用他们的专业度和就是我们这些LGBT 的一些机构，那我们能够去共同讨论一些可能长久和长远的一些计划，那这个也是我们现在要做的一个事情，就是让他们能够来到美国，那其实去看就是两国不同的一些经验，能够去看到两国不同的一些这种方式方法，在不同的体系下我们如何去运用，包括我们能够去更深的去看未来，我们是希望能够更长久的去推动一些法治方面的一些东西。
So the program that we're about to establish, which is actually going to start next month, is where we're bringing four lawyers from China who are interested in LGBT cases and who had some litigation experience to the U.S. and work with Lambda Legal and other organizations to develop a strategy arm for the Chinese LGBT movement so that they can have a focused and directed strategy in case selection, in victim collection, in a selection, as well as in maximizing the result of the judgment.
Thank you. Now, Damien, we build you as the interpreter, but you're doing so much more than that. And tell us a little bit about the work you're doing with the BI website and the work you've been doing with the center and some of the challenges you're facing.
So as John was saying, I started off working in this arena in China, at least as a kind of a gay Dear Abby there. So I answer so far, it's been 17 years now. I answer about 30 to 50 questions a day. And since that this was about 17 years ago, since then I've been involved in many organizations in China. I know most of the Chinese activists. I think I was before we started. I was talking to Bob. I think the recent challenge is for the entire LGBT movement in China is very much what Mao Mao Yu said, that the whole movement is going through some soul search. A few years ago, when the Chinese government was changing hands, the regime change, at the time, many people in the West believed the new regime would be more open to change and political change. So there were also many international organizations and foundations that geared up towards supporting legislative changes, political changes, and so forth. Well, it turns out that wasn't true. The new regime is more repressive than their predecessor. So we're facing an issue where there are organizations that have done things that are, in the Chinese context, very cutting edge. We had a young man in his early 20s who were trying to organize the first Chinese gay pride parade. The reality, though, is that those public, very open advocacy activities, I have to say, in some ways, kind of directed from abroad. The result is actually it caused the majority of the LGBT individuals to distance themselves from these organizations, because that's not what they're concerned every day. They're concerned with facing their parents, facing their workplace. That those are their first challenges. So I think, as Joe was implying, what happened is the Chinese LGBT movement, because they're learning from the West, skipped over the community building part of it, started advocating to the society at large very early on, but you don't have a community foundation. In other words, the majority of the LGBT people in China barely accept themselves and are still struggling. So I think I am at least saying this to virtually anybody who want to listen, is that we need to refocus on taking care of our own people first. You have to have a base to do any civil society work. So that's the challenge. But we also have to kind of spread that message almost abroad, because the reality is that most of the Chinese LGBT organizations receive financial support from abroad. Those support, of course, has some directions regarding where things are going. Many organizations are facing a terrible choice. Either they refuse these funding, or if they take the funding, they have to do something that might be very newsworthy and very sexy, but not very helpful.
And that's always the risk where developed countries or Western countries try to force the replication of our rights movement in a place where it's not appropriate or it doesn't really work. And Bob, you certainly work in a lot of different regions, some of them very repressive governments, some with no government at all, Muslim countries, some fundamental Christian countries. How do you deal with working with LGBT activists in parts of the world where it's so challenging? And what's your strategy?
Sure. I mean, to both of those points, I think part of the reason Astraea has been around for so long and is because of our deep commitment to not give directive funding. So we give completely flexible funding. We likely, if there's any kind of LGBTQ or I organization in the world that has received funding, we've probably made the first grant. We have a core commitment to funding nascent and emerging groups, and we fund flexibly. So we don't have programmatic directives. Who are we to say what should be happening on the ground in other countries? But also, if you can't keep your lights on, how are you going to meet your programmatic needs? So we really take the cues from activists on the ground. And then there's the real issue of the barriers that governments put in place for money to get in country. China, India, Malaysia. I mean, there are many countries that have deep restrictions and or are building restrictions around foreign funding coming in. And then specifically, if you look at where the most repressive laws around LGBT issues are, likely that those laws are not just about cultural homophobia. They're often, I call it the gay canary in the minefield, but right, they're often about restricting civil society writ large, and they can rally around LGBT issues. And we see that in our own country, right? So it's also about where people can't take a stand, that we can take a stand on global stages, and then also concurrently fund the most local work, the most hyper-local work around the world safely, and really prioritizing the agendas and the needs that the activists are setting themselves.
I think that's just such an important point, because a lot of activists in the United States want to be involved in the global struggle, but we have to respect the people who are in those countries and who are working on the ground, and sometimes our activism might end up endangering them and setting the movement back. So we really have to be strategic and thoughtful, and as you said, we have to really partner with those who are doing the work. We talked earlier on about what happened in Orlando and the terrible attack and loss of life. We know that that is just part of one of many incidents against LGBT people. It's what we, many of us, grow up with, hatred and discrimination and violence. How does that affect the work of all of you? I mean, have you had time to even process what that is going to mean in terms of the work you're doing? Mm. I don't know if anyone... Joe, you're looking at me like you might want to start with this one.
我觉得其实对于中国的工作其实没有什么太大影响，因为其实有一个很好玩的一个事情，就是其实我们就是在这件事情发生以后，其实全球的媒体都在去报道这件事情。那其实大家在报道的时候都会提到这是一个同志的一个酒吧，但是唯独在中国的主流媒体在报道的时候，他把同性恋三个字隐去了，他就说美国的一家夜总会。所以其实很多的人知道了这件事情，但他其实并不知道这个是发生在一个同志身上的一个事情。
It's very interesting that when the tragedy happened worldwide, people reported it as a tragedy at a gay club, except the Chinese news agency that just said it was a nightclub. So most Chinese people probably even now do not know this was a gay establishment.
所以其实对于我们这些在国内的一些运动家来讲的话，其实这件事情能够去在同志内部有一些讨论，我觉得这个是比较好的一个事情。但是我觉得其实要去但其实是不太一样的，就是因为中国的情况会更复杂，因为其实我觉得在西方的话更多的是因为宗教的原因，但是其实在中国的话其实宗教并不是一个主要的问题。那其实在这个事情上，对于相对于来说的话，对于中国的LGBT 的人群来讲呢，其实它并没有一个很深的一个就是感同身受的一个部分。
As far as the movement itself, I think the good thing is that this will start some discussions aboutwhat the Chinese LGBT people face, which is different. It is a religious encroachment is happening, but it isn't a major force. Most people are still facing issues that are related to family and other cultural, social pressures. But it starts a discussion, and I'm just editorial a little bit. I think what's really will be useful for the Chinese discussion is there is a misconception on the Chinese LGBT side. Many people believe that US LGBT people are living in heaven, that we had it like this today, always like this. And so most of them don't know the struggle that we went through to get to this point. So this will, in a way, hopefully help more people to have a resolve to do something, in their own countries.
所以我觉得其实在国内的话，对于我们来讲的话，我觉得更重要的一部分其实还是在LGBT群体里边的一些自我认同的一些部分。因为其实我们再去关注一些网友的言论的时候，除了其实我们会看到一些非常不太好的一些言论，当然就是第一是一些异性恋的群体会觉得说啊，很多的这些同志就应该被杀死等等之类的。 包括可能会谈到一些就是美国的一些人权的部分。那其实还有另外一种声音，我们看到其实非常的气愤，就是说很多的一些同志内部的人，他会说，那如果你是一个好的一个gay，如果你早回家的话，你就不会有这样的一些事情。So
here is an example of what I was saying earlier about internalized homophobia. We saw on the Chinese media many people commenting on the tragedy, and clearly there were non-LGBT people who were saying horrible things like, oh, you know, gays, they should die anyway. But what really disturbing to us are gay people saying, well, if you're a good gay man, you should have gone home earlier, then this wouldn't have happened to you.
所以我们会希望说，其实从我觉得从内部的一些可能这种倡导也好，等等内部的一些自我认同的部分，其实是更重要的。This
is why we believe that, again, China needs the most today in community building, in helping individuals accepting themselves and, you know, reach the stage of pride. That's probably more important than social advocacy.
And I think your comment earlier about visibility and the suppression of the fact that this was an LGBT club, I think that's something that is part of the struggle, is having the self-awareness, the self-respect to eventually be more open and out, because as long as we're invisible, they can discriminate against us.
The Chinese government does not have a systematic way of oppressing LGBT people, except that you have no rights to speak. In other words, no organization can put an ad in a newspaper. And that's probably the control of information dissemination and the media is probably the worst thing. That's all of them faces the same issue. They in a city like Beijing, and they're the Beijing LGBT center, but majority of the LGBT people in China don't know they exist.
And I liked your comment about U.S. being heaven for the LGBT community, but maybe that's because you're bringing the activists to Los Angeles and training them here. Maybe we should have you take them to, I don't know, Alabama and have the training there. They might have a different perspective. Mulan, do you want to comment about what happened in Orlando and what you see that as a going forward as a challenge for you? How is that going to impact your work?
Okay. For myself, before I came to America, I think I will go to a better country they are more friendly for LGBT people. I have hope to come here. And when I know the news, I was very surprised. In my eye, that's the best country for LGBT, but this attack is the worst for LGBT. And my friends in China, they contact me after one day or 2 days of this this accident. They saw the news on the internet. And the lesbian friends, they were worried about me, and they were angry too. We have a chat group of internet, and the members in the group, they shared the news, and they talked about why the people couldn't accept the LGBT people and so on. They talked about this thing, and I think, but I read many news of media in China. Most I saw many media, they mentioned LGBT in the title, and media of CCTV. CCTV is the media of China, of the government. They published an article on internet, and in the title they didn't mention gay or homosexual. And at last of the article, they mentioned one time this is a homosexual club. I think this is a step to accept us, because normally this media, CCTV, it presents the China. See, if they mention LGBT, that means the government, maybe they know, they accept the people in one way or another. And for LGBT people, I feel yesterday I went to the city hall, the activity. I feel the unity of community. In China, I have never been in an activity like this, because the different culture, different situation. But I can feel the same unity of community of all. Of our community, when they saw the news and when they share their emotions, their feelings, they feel not good, and they want to do something to change the world.
Yeah. That's great. I don't know, Bob. Do you want to jump in, or Rain? Do you want to talk about how you see this tragic event? This terrorist attack on a gay club, how you see that affecting your work? I'm going to let Bob have the last word then.
Okay. Firstly, I received a lot of emails from my friends, because they knew I'm in US now. They asked me, are you safe now? Many Chinese, they don't know America so much, very much. They don't know Los Angeles is very far from Orlando. They don't know Los Angeles is very far from Orlando. They don't know I'm in America now, so I'm safe. For my work, I want to tell something to you. Yesterday and the day before yesterday, about 200 Chinese LGBT organizations
They signed a letter. They jointly signed a letter.
Yeah, and so my organization joined the
letter. Yes. So they wrote an open letter in support of the Orlando victims and their family, about 200 Chinese organizations.
Mm-hmm. And yesterday, and some activities were held.
And there were memorial services in Shanghai and Beijing.
And Guangzhou. So now I speak Chinese now. 我觉得对于中国的同志组织来说呢, 奥兰多事件可能会有一个深远的影响。
I think the event will have a profound impact on the Chinese activists.
它让中国的同志组织就是有一个发声的，并且是集合起来发声的机会。对，it's
an opportunity for the groups to join together to speak out publicly.
因为我们实际上在中国，我们作为同志组织来说，我们最更多的是对社群来说话，而很少有对其他的社群、对其他的对社会去表达的机会。
Most of the time, we can only speak to our own community. The means we at our disposal only allow us to speak to our own community. And this is an opportunity for us to speak to the society at large regarding discrimination that LGBT people face worldwide.
往往只有等到一些不好的事情发生的时候, 我们才能够让我们更加的就是聚集起来有勇敢的并且有这样一个机会让我们去表达我们自己。
So it's unfortunate that it took a tragedy to have an opportunity for us to jointly speak out clearly and loudly.
所以奥兰多事件对我们不仅仅是对我们组织来说，而对整个中国同志的组织来说呢，它可能会就是让我们更加的成熟。So
we think that the reporting about the event and the understanding of it will help many activists to mature.
因为我们看到这样一个有你这么多的我们的就是说我们的兄弟姐妹，他们虽然是在异国他乡，他们被屠杀，但是我们实际上是感同身受。
When you see so many of your sisters and brothers, even though from another country, being murdered in cold blood, it causes a lot of people to think.
一度我们认为美国的同志很幸福，因为他们可以结婚，而我们不可以。
We used to think that gays and lesbians in the U.S. are very happy because they can get married.
但是我们现在意识到，即使是已经通过已经是结婚的国家，然后权力就是平权的斗争依然是任重而道远。Now
that we know, even in a country where same-sex marriage is possible, the road is still meandering and is very long.
那么对于我们 中国这样，我们目前还不能去公开讨论同性恋的国家来说呢。那么我们作为同志组织，我们更加清醒地认识到我们的处境是什么样子的。And
in a country like China, where there is no protection of any kind, no anti-discrimination laws protecting LGBT people, we are better now to understand where we are in the history of the movement.
包括现在有，其实，刚才有讲到，中国是在传统上是没有宗教反同势力的，但是现在有一些外来的宗教，它的反同其实也逐渐去渗透到中国。So
we talked about religion not being a major player, but as I was saying earlier, and he's saying that now it is increasingly becoming a player. Clearly, there are more fundamental Christians that are going into China with the deliberate purpose of missionary work, and many of them are very homophobic.
这让对于还处于婴儿阶段的我们的中国的同志组织来说呢，我们未来的挑战会很大。所以，我想作为一个同志工作者，我通过这个事件，我会觉得我们会更加的清醒，知道我们未来还有很长很长的路要走。可能美国人已经走得很远，但我们还在后面。其实我们是，就是我们要追得很久。
For organizations like mine, which are very young, we don't have experience in dealing with religious fundamentalism. So things like this, again, cause us to examine our mission, for us to think about what we might have to face in the future.
但是我想我们绝对不会低头，对。
Of course, we are not going to bow down.
That's great. Bob, you work with some very vulnerable populations around the world. As you said, the oppression of LGBT people in places, sometimes it's part of a much broader oppression, oppression that exists throughout the society. How do incidents like what happened in Orlando affect the work that you're doing through Astraea?
Sure. I mean, I think whenever any tragedy happens, the first thing that people ask is why? You know, why did this happen? And I think in this country, I really appreciate everything everyone said, and I think that we can really reflect on the why from what folks said. We know, again, we can learn from all kinds of situations. In South Africa, for example, South Africa has the best laws on the books protecting LGBTI people. It's in the Constitution. But black South Africans who are lesbian or gender nonconforming are brutally murdered. and quote-unquote correctively raped constantly. So we know laws don't necessarily protect us, or they don't name our lived experience, but the cultural attitudes and assumptions are often how our daily lives are affected. In this country, while we have marriage equality, we know that laws have not always been designed to protect our citizens. Slavery was legal, segregation was legal, women were legally not allowed to vote, black people were legally not allowed to vote. Those are those aren't protections for the individual citizens of this country. Those are protections for the cultural attitudes of this country. And the violence that occurred in Orlando happened because there is a script of violence that that gunman followed. So a year ago, someone sat and prayed with people in Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, and then shot the people in that room. This man walked into Pulse and had a drink, had visited that bar multiple times, sat in congregation with the people in that bar, and then took fire. It doesn't make the crime any less heinous, but it does start to answer the question, why? When we are in an environment where there's such vitriol being spewed against in our political realm, when there's violence that is being brought up as solutions by people either in office or running for office, when
we don't have to mention any names,
right?
I think we know who you're talking
right.
about.
Exactly. That it isn't specifically around Latino people. It isn't a mistake that it was Latino night in that, in and Pride and Ramadan, right? It that like those aren't just facts that lay on the side. Those are deep truths that have been supported, and the pathway was created for a man who worked for a military organization, who was studying to be a police officer, who had been investigated twice by the FBI, who had beat his wife, who used racial slurs on a daily basis and equated his attitudes around other human beings as being protected and reified if that level of violence occurred. That is how an Orlando happens. And so in terms of my own work, often I have to justify why Astraea would also name ourselves a gender justice organization, a racial justice organization, an economic justice organization, why we connect technologists and LGBT human rights defenders globally and say freedom of speech is an LGBT issue, freedom from surveillance is an LGBT issue, the laws governing technology and information are LGBT issues. In a very twisted way, this may make my job easier, because now I if I don't understand what it is to walk in a black body, maybe this makes me a little bit more aware. If I don't understand what it is to walk in a gender nonconforming body or a poor body or a woman's body, this might help me understand that and be compassionate and see how those issues are connected.
Great. And I you know, Your comments about violence in society, I was watching TV and they were advertising two new shows that were extraordinarily violent, and the ads had people with guns and shooting, and I'm thinking, why do these things happen? The question is, why don't more of them happen when we are fed this daily diet of violence on television and in movies? So I think we can't divorce the incident from the level of violence generally in society.
Mm-hmm.
There are a number of, I'm sure a number of the people in the audience have some questions. We're going to turn to those in a moment. I want to ask a little bit about what your perspective is on how U.S. activists can help the work that is happening globally. If there were activists here, and I know there are, who wanted to support the work that's being done in China or the work that you're doing in Ecuador or in Africa,
mm-hmm.
how do they get connected, and what would be the best thing they could do to help move the dial on LGBT equality.
Mm-hmm. Do you want me to answer?
Yeah, you start, but I think Mulan wants to jump in too.
Yeah, you guys go first.
I'm the intern of later emergency program of Los Angeles LGBT Center. So this is an opportunity for me to learn from the American LGBT leaders. I think compared to different culture, we can't copy the activities, we can't copy the service, or we can't copy the ways they do in America. But this program, the most important for me, it really impressed me. I saw the big center of so many services, so many departments, and I saw so many people work for LGBT people. Not only LGBT people, there are many straight staff in this center. I feel the passion, I feel the hope. Before I came here, I don't know there was a so big center. I know this is the biggest center, but before I saw it, I don't know this is so huge. Yeah. So this experience for me it really inspired me. And we visited so many activities, so many leaders of center, and we asked them many problems. We talked about the different problems. We shared our stories. We shared different situations in America, in China. And they can teach us some experience, or they can give us an advice. Maybe this not the best, but we can learn it, and we can to take it to China. And maybe after I come to China, I will talk about my experiences with my partners in China, with our volunteers, and I think we will find a better way to do our work.
So it sounds like information sharing and giving you this experience of seeing what is done here is really a great way to partner.
Yes, it's really helpful.
And that was a great commercial for the work of the LA Gay and Lesbian Center and the range of programs that we're so fortunate to have there. And I want to also acknowledge Daryl Cummings here from the center and thank you for spearheading this program and partnering with us tonight. Bob, you were eager to jump on this question. In terms of U.S. activists and their role to support the work you're doing and the work that's being done in other countries, what would you tell U.S. activists how to get involved?
Sure. I think that you know, at the end of the day, like, this is also a conversation about power, right? So what does it mean to not have power, and what does it mean to actually tap in to the power that you do have? And I think the point that you made about going to City Hall and standing in community, I mean, I think that that's actually our greatest asset, and that's, you know, why I'm lucky to have my job, honestly, because I get to help people come together. So it's really easy to get involved with Astraea, besides, you know, like hitting me up afterwards or going on our website joining. But I think what you actually have the opportunity to do is aggregate power, right? And so and that's actually a stunning proposition, that there's actually, I mean, often when something happens, people say, like, what can I do? And people don't realize how the breadth of organizing that's happening around the world or even in this country, and getting access to that information is one of the greatest, like the most empowering tools of all from wherever you're sitting. And then to actually be able to get plugged in to the work that is happening all over the world, and depending on what your assets are, being able to help bring those to the table is really a profound proposition. And there's no place where there isn't a point of entry, actually.
Damien, I'm going to turn to you and ask you, since you've been working with this program with Chinese activists for many years now, where do you see the role of U.S. activists in terms of the work that's being done in China? Would that be at all helpful, or would it potentially undermine the work that's being done in China?
No, I think it will be very helpful. First of all, I want to say a few words about Daryl and this program. Daryl not only spearheaded this, he's been extremely personally involved with these activists, even after they went back to China. He's always been, he and Lori Jin had also been a great advocate for Chinese LGBT movement worldwide. They've been speaking to other organizations, to U.S. State Departments. So through them, I think the Chinese LGBT movement has benefited greatly already. But I mention this because one time Daryl and I were in China in a smaller city, and a lesbian organization hosted us, and we were going to give a lecture. On the way there in the taxi, there was an activist who is also the leader of the group, asked us separately in English and Chinese, that what did you think the Chinese LGBT people need the most as far as human talent? And we both, without talking ahead of time, said MBAs. And the reason we said that is because the Chinese movement is moving to a stage where previously all amateur type of activities can only sustain them to a certain point. So I think if there's any activist with professional experiences, mental health professionals, legal, medical, Chinese transgender people desperately need medical help. Many transgender people die in China because they are not under proper supervision and they're taking medications, going through surgeries, and being harmed. So from that perspective, I think there are many things, if people are interested to get involved, that they can do. But as we were saying earlier in the forum, I think John articulated it really well, that this has to be done in conjunction with the local organizations, because as you have seen, Beijing, mm-hmm. Anhui, Dongbei, they have very different cultural background. What can be done in one city is not necessarily true for another city. But for people who are interested in doing things, I think there are a lot of opportunities. Many groups will welcome people who, you know, strategic planning, research. Yesterday, I was approached by an activist who wants to do research. And most of us are almost tired of these onesie, you know, surveys, and then never heard about it again. Nobody has ever done any longitudinal study to compare attitudes and so forth. So there are a lot of skills that are lacking, clearly. Moral support, financial support, I think in general, even though we talked about misconceptions, I still think there are more Chinese LGBT people who know about the U.S. LGBT situation than U.S. LGBT people who know about what's happening in China. Mm-hmm. I think that's, in a way, that's a problem, actually. So I think there are a lot that can, mm-hmm. that could be very helpful.
And it's also why we're lucky to have all of you here sharing your experience. Joe, you've had the opportunity to participate previously. What do you think would be most helpful in terms of U.S. activists if they wanted to support the work you're doing?
我觉得其实资源是最重要的，其实钱是一部分，但是呢，其实现在对于我们来讲的话，其实这届的政府对于中国的管控是非常严的，所以其实你会发现，其实现在很多的基金进入中国其实也并不容易。
In all honesty, probably money is the most important thing. beginning next year, the Chinese government is implementing a new law regarding controlling foreign funds going into China for civil society work, it will make it even harder for international support from a money perspective.
但是其实对于我们来讲的话，其实我们会发现，对于国际的这些支持，包括可能很多国际的一些经验，我觉得最重要的其实还是由国内的运动家需要去有一个很深的一个思考。就是因为其实对于西方的一些经验，包括可能离中国，就是包括台湾、香港的一些经验，其实往往很多时候是并不适用于中国。但是其实我们很多时候再去借鉴西方的经验的时候，在中国去运用的时候，其实它是会有一个。 不一样的一个效果，所以我觉得其实我们能，我觉得能，我希望说能够你们提供给就是我们的是你们曾经可能走过的一些弯路，包括可能一些就是经验的一些部分，包括一些可能方法的部分，包括说能够去给我们共同去讨论说那适合于我们在这个地方去做什么。我觉得其实最重要的还是应该是要由我们国内的这些同志运动家，包括可能国内的这些同志社区的这些人能够去有一个更深的认识。
So many movement trends and directions, experiences have been passed to China, but often they are without context. So people in China knew, for example, they know about Stonewall, but they think that's when gay movement started. So there are a lot of, in other words, when we introduce Western experiences, we want to know about failures. We want to know about things that didn't work, as well as things that did work. And then the Chinese movement or activists need to really examine these things and digest them, particularly with context, and then to decide whether these are effective or safe for the Chinese movement to adopt or not. Mm-hmm.
我会觉得说，其实像我们现在这种交流，包括其实像洛杉矶同中心的这种实习的这个项目，其实是非常好的。因为在每次有新的实习生过来的时候，那其实我们会跟他们讲说，你们来这边并不是来去学习的，而是说你们能够去希望能够去参观，能够去看到他们的经验。那其实回过头来去思考说，我们在国内能够去做什么？我觉得这个其实是由你们能够带给我们的，而不是说你们来告诉我们说。 提供给我们说你我们应该去做什么？我觉得这个是非常重要的。那但这一点呢，其实是很多的国内的一些同志运动家并没有认识到和意识到的一个部分，就是我们他只是觉得说，可能西方的经验，包括可能西方已经包括美国可能已经同志运动这么多年，那他的经验一定是好的，但是其他并没有考虑到两国的国情不一样，政治体系不一样，社会环境不一样，家庭等等各方面，其实都是有区别的。
I think this forum and the program with the center are both very good venues for that information dispersal. When new interns come to the U.S., I always tell them that you're not only to learn skills, but you need to experience. You need to feel what a movement is like and what an NGO, an LGBT NGO is like. Because that's different than being told this is the thing you should be doing. This will give us the opportunity to examine, again, as I said, experiences and failures in the context of both U.S. history and the Chinese cultural and social conditions so that people can be inspired on one hand, but on the other hand, learn how to adapt strategies that will work in China.
所以其实包括谈到钱的部分，因为，对于我们来讲，其实不可能一直去找国外的一些基金会。当然，其实中国政府是非常有钱的。那其实，在中国的gay也是非常有钱的。但是为什么，在对于中国来讲呢？其实我们拿不到政府的钱，拿不到中国就是从社区身上他们能够去支持在中国的这些 LGBT 的这些机构，而是说我们非要一直去依靠西方的这些基金会等等之类的。我觉得这个都是我们需要去。 思考的东西，那这些我觉得其实我们是希望能够去从美国，包括等等之前，就是你们能够你们之前有一个怎样的一个过程，然后到现在，我觉得这些经验其实给我们是非常重要。那我觉得最重要的还是说，我们应该去国内这些同志运动家能够去从这些经验上去思考，从我们的一个部分去出发，去看怎么去在国内去开展一些工作。
Take an example of money. The Chinese government is very rich. And there are many very rich gay people in China. But all the organizations in China today are still primarily relying on international funding. So why is that? And I think that is something we are all struggling with and trying to find answers. So the past experience in the US regarding how you persuaded gay people to cough up their money and how you get government to support programs like the Center Have for Youth and so forth, it's definitely something we very much need. But that doesn't mean necessarily, for example, a particular fundraising technique will work in China. So I think we're trying to make a distinction there between a specific skill that can be taught in a school or a classroom setting versus a rich tradition of movement, mm-hmm. including the people involved, the culture, the community, comprehensively. Those are both inspiring as well as very helpful. And I think I was going to say that Daryl certainly believes that. I think when he meets with the activists, he I think he's really good. And I've heard this from many, many interns, that he challenges them and inspires them. Many of them, prior to coming to the U.S., never thought about what they would be doing 5 years from now. They're just, as Bob was saying, they're just at the subsistence level. But now they're beginning to think that we need to have plans. We're going to stay.
Let me ask Rain, and then we have time. John said we have time for about three questions from the audience. But let me ask you, Rain, in terms of U.S. Support for the work you're doing, what would be helpful? And as part of that, I don't know if you connect with the Trevor Project while you're here. Since you work with youth, it's a big organization that focuses on providing information to LGBT and questioning youth. And Damien, I don't know if you need to translate that.
首先我觉得交流非常的重要，对。
So I think first, exchange of information is extremely important.
我们一般都认为，说啊，中国和美国的文化差异是非常非常大的。
So many people believe that the cultural differences between the U.S. and China is so huge that it's virtually incomparable.
但实际上世界正在变小，我在我的国家那一个很小的我在我的家乡一个很小的地方，我们就经常看到很多的外国人，但我在洛杉矶也会经常看到很多说中国话的人，并且也是我们的老乡。
But the world has gotten smaller and smaller. So in my hometown, in a very rural area, I see a lot of foreign visitors. And when I came to LA, I hear a lot of people speaking Chinese, some my own hometown accent.
虽然大家普遍上认为中国是一个共产主义国家，但实际上它现在比资本主义还要资本主义。
So even though people think China is a communist country, but it is actually more capitalist than the U.S. I was saying this to Bob, ironically, just earlier.
所以很多的美国人可能他并不知道这一点，就是。尽管中国政府他不去说，就是除了在政治方面的其他的领域，他其实都在学习美国。
So we believe that the Chinese government, aside from the political philosophy and political system, virtually everything else, they are largely modeling themselves after the U.S. the financial system, the healthcare system reform, and so forth.
所以在美国他所经历的事情在几十年或者十几年之后中国都会经历到。
So what you've experienced in the U.S. in the past and now might be what we'll be facing in the next decade.
在 LGBT 领域 也是一样，就比如那个就像洛杉矶同志中心的这个项目，他从几年前从八年前开始，然后中国几乎所有的大型的同志机构都基本上都来过洛杉矶。
So for example, the internship program started 8 years ago, And today, all of the major LGBT organizations in China have sent their leaders through this program.
他们回去之后做了很多的事情, 给中国的同志运动带来了非常大的变化。
And they have changed the movement and directly benefited the community. They've done many things as a result of this program.
我们经常看到有中国的同志组织做了一个新的项目, 我们觉得这个项目很有创意, 但是当我们来到美国之后发现, 这个项目是以前洛杉矶同志婚姻做过的项目。
So we often run into situations where a group in China started a new program and said, oh, that's really, you know, interesting and new. And then we found out that they were just, they've been in the center and they learned that from the center.
所以这就是这样的一个情况。但是另一方面，就像刚才谢欣老师所Damien所说的，其实中国美国人对中国的了解其实比中国对美国的了解是要少的。
And then, but on the other hand, as I was saying earlier, it appears that the U.S. LGBT people know less about the Chinese LGBT situation than vice versa.
所以我们现在也看到Daryl和Damien他们也经常会去中国还有Laura Jean。
So we know that Laura Jean, Daryl, myself, we will go to China every other year.
所以我们觉得这个是非常的重要，因为如果只是中国的组织去单方面的去学习，美国人以前所做过的什么，就像刚才郭子阳所说的，我们可能学到的，就是他这样是说可能并不是那么的完美，是的。
So I think this because that means there are some two-way understanding and learning about each other. I think that's really important, and that'll help. I think, to go back to John's earlier question, that will help guide the organizations as well as individuals here who wants to help China. I think Daryl has certainly done a lot of that kind of work.
所以我觉得美国的同志运动家可能也需要更多的去中国看一看。
So we think more of you should come to China.
Yeah, I'm taking that as an invite. You've just invited us all to come and visit in China.
So
maybe when you go there, you will see what happened in 10 years ago in the U.S. is now happening in China.
也会看到一些中国的同志组织在做的一些比较有意思的东西，可能是跟美国是不一样的。
And then you might see some group doing things that are very foreign, very different from what happened in the U.S.
但总体上可能还是中国的组织向美国的学习需要更多一点。
Of course, I think there are more for us to learn from you.
关于第二个问题的话，我没有跟那个组织联系过，我不知道这个组织。
He's not aware of the Travers. Project.
Okay, well, maybe that's something that Daryl will take you to while you're here. I think there's a lot for us to learn from each other, and we really appreciate you being here tonight and spending so much time and sharing your experiences. I know our audience probably has some questions, and we have a limited amount of time. John has the microphone, so he's going to control. We have a couple of people over here.
Hi, my name is Sean, and thank you so much for all being here. It was very informative. I have two questions, both related, and both have to do, first one, with power in numbers, and second, access to technology. I read somewhere that some Chinese university did some studies, and there are 16 million sham marriages in China. Gay men who marry straight people, and so huge number, half the population of Canada, according to that university, are married in these fake marriages. And the second question, probably tied to the first one, is one of you made a comment that many Chinese people don't have proper access to information. So even if events are happening in their own cities, they don't know if there are organizations, gay organizations. And me being from Iran, I know that even in a country like Iran, people have access to satellite dishes and they hack the internet and are very well informed of everything that's going on. So the question is, one, do you have any comments on power in numbers? The millions of Chinese gay and women who evidently get into fake marriages, and how can we how can they bypass the restrictions on technology to get more mobilized?
Okay. Anyone want to take that question? The first question has to do with fake or sham marriages in China. And the second one has to do with expanding technology or access to technology. And I know, Bob, I'm going to ask you about that too, because that's part of what you do just generally is help connect people through technology. Anyone want to try this one? Damien?
I think the problem, the biggest problem is not sham marriages. The term sham marriage in China has a specific meaning. It's a arranged marriage between a lesbian and a gay man. So they're doing this only for their family's sake. That is, to most Chinese activists, that's better than a fake marriage where an innocent straight person unknowingly get into this kind of marriage. That's the biggest problem. Over 85% of Chinese gay men marry straight women without telling them. That's a bigger problem. So many activists today think that sham marriages is lesser of the two evils. But this is related to what I said earlier at the beginning of this forum. We need self-identity building. We need that more than anything else. Because people, if they can't accept themselves, they can't face their family. They can't face the work environment. Then that's when they get forced into getting married. And of course, it creates a whole slew of other social problems. It's also a feminist problem because some of this is very misogynistic. There are many gay men who believe that if I just provide an economic security to the woman, I can do whatever I want. So I think both are problems, and now there are some activists who are saying that the first type of sham marriage between a lesbian and gay man is a kind of capitulation to the normality, and so there are people who are challenging, saying that we shouldn't be doing that. But this is a regional difference. We even had one of the activists here whose organization's route was to help people arranging for this kind of marriages. So there is a disparity on that.
So are you saying that the LGBT community in China actually has fights amongst itself?
Regarding
then your
this
movement
issue.
Has really arrived. When the community is fighting among
one
itself,
of things.
Then it's really arrived.
Exactly.
Bob, you've worked in a lot of places where access to technology is a challenge because of finances, electricity,
sure.
But you've been able to fund work in certain parts of the world where technology is a key component mm-hmm. of providing access to information. How do you go about doing that work, and do you think it's successful?
Yeah, so we launched about 4 years ago something called the Comms Labs, which is a media communications and technology initiative where we bring human rights defenders and technologists together. We launched in Latin America, and we brought activists from rural and urban areas, from political leanings who would never be in the same room, from Honduras, Ecuador, Peru, Colombia, and one other country that I'm spacing, Guatemala. And so the most radical trans activists from the city to the lesbian separatists from the mountains of Honduras, who were like, what have you done? Why are we here together? And we were like, just trust us. But in part, they did, right? That's why they were there, because we'd had long-standing relationships with folks. And we brought technologists together and said, okay, what are the tools that you need in order to get your work done? Before we did all of this, we did deep analyses of the ways technology was used in each of those countries. So for example, Colombia has one of the largest attrition rates around internet use, whereas Peru has over 1,000 radio programs that are shown. So we know it's not just this, what we undermine is this idea of where innovation lies, right? It's not just the providence of Silicon Valley, right? It's the usually the most disadvantaged people are the most innovative. Right, and are developing tools all the time to meet our needs, right? So, but so in Peru, for example, so similarly, it's not just because in Colombia they had more internet access that technology could get used more rapidly, but in Peru we knew storytelling is an effective tool if there's already a culture of radio programming, for example. But we also did really innovative things, right? So a lot of trans women get their drugs on the street, but those are setups often for robberies and acts of violence. So they developed an app that was based on SMS, right? So texting, because that was the technology and the tool that was most readily available to say, hey, this is safe here, this is unsafe there. Now we've also created a network of activists who are talking to each other regionally, right? So not just across city or rural areas, but around countries. The lesbian separatists in Honduras have a database that they've been developing over years, where they document acts of violence against LGBT people. If the person is alive, they use all of the data that they've aggregated to help advocate for their rights, whether it's medically or legally. They are responsible for hate crime law legislation in that country. If the person is dead, they advocate that they're properly gendered, for example. Their safety protocol at the time of the comms labs was to carry the drives around with them, right? So needless to say, that's no longer their safety protocol, but also that database has been repurposed in three other countries. So that's one way that we've worked. Now, we have comms labs in South Africa and Kenya. They don't look the same as in Colombia. They shouldn't. And so that's what I was talking about, a culture of indigeneity and prioritizing what does an African comms labs need to look like. And the Southern African and Eastern African activists wanted to be together, even though their access to technology is radically, radically different, but they don't get to movement build across those geographies often. And this was an opportunity to do that. And then we're also building relationships and allyships across the people who live in the tech world that often don't have access. And so they are developing and undermining similarly as folks do in Iran, right? That what are the ways to communicate? What are the ways to bifurcate restrictions? And how do we do that in ways that are particularly safe and viable and vibrant for LGBTQ people? And this has been one of our most sort of surprising and rigorous projects because it really was developing sort of a meta culture on top of culture on top of culture. In the technology world, there's like this statement of like fail often, right? But we know in our communities that failing means dying. So how do you even create an environment where you get to be creative that feels safe? And so that we understood that was a core part of our work. I could go blather on for hours, but I think that the in Iran and in the Middle East, there's a network of Middle East and North African activists out of Lebanon, for example. And technology is a key way that people stay in touch and organize. And we make use of the networks and the systems that we have that are human, and we also need to make use of the networks and the systems that we have that are electronic and available to us in those kinds of ways. And so that's for us what it means to also grow over the course of 40 years. That's our own evolution as well.
And it sounds like, as we've been saying with so many things tonight, what works in one setting may not work in
Absolutely.
Another, and we have to take the technology that may be working in one place and come up with a completely different way of connecting people technologically in another venue. There was a woman here who had a question. And
hi, thank you all. I've learned a lot from your expertise, your comments tonight. So I have a two-part question as well. I'm interested in what we can learn from you all. So I know that, Mayor, you asked, like, oh, what might you need from the U.S., but what can you teach us in return from your, like, specific activism? And sort of connected, I know, Damien, you talked about on the ground, the concern is like family and individual acceptance. So what are the tactics that you all have employed that have worked or haven't worked, or that you're working through to help like your actual local communities?
The panel is thinking.
I'll just give you an example on the first part of your question regarding self-acceptance. And Daryl and I had several conversations about this. One of the most effective things that's happened is actually, again, one of our past graduates from this internship program. He was a businessman, but doing some LGBT work in spare time. After this program, he went back and reorganized and revitalized the Chinese version of PFLAG. And that turned out to be much, much more effective than many LGBT organizations themselves, precisely because of the things you just said. Because family and family control of their kids is so important in the Asian community that the PFLAG parents had a tremendous impact, not just on their own kids. People used to believe that no Chinese parents would ever accept a gay kid or a lesbian kid, and that's certainly changing. And they're one of the most visible LGBT organizations in China. It's also one of the fastest growing. I believe now they're in 40 different cities with chapters. And it's in some ways not exactly modeled after PFLAG in the U.S. It's a little different. Their meeting is more like a witness meeting. People are providing testimonies, and there's a lot of crying and soul searching, but it's very effective. Not only to those LGBT people whose parents accepted them, but at large, even in the straight society, it's garnered some notice. So that's one of the things. Clearly, I think in all Asian countries, we joke about it here. The parents, couldn't wait till kids turn 18, they leave. And in China, 40-year-old people who are still consulting their parents about job choices and so forth. So that dynamic, the result of that is PFLAG is very, very effective in China.
Other comments? There was also the question about what can we learn from your experience. Have you seen things in this country? As you've been at the center and you've looked at the amazing programs they have, and as you've had an opportunity to experience life here for a short period of time, what are some of the things that we can learn from the experience you have?
比如你们觉得就是在美国看过以后，在中心看过以后，觉得中国就是美国的同志运动能够从中国学到什么东西？
Daryl.
Decided you should ask Daryl that question. So he said, I think maybe it's about how to work in an extremely, extremely adversarial and difficult environment. But I think the reality is that, some of our oldest activists can tell you they did the same thing too.
But, and I think that's a lesson maybe not for Los Angeles, but for other parts of the country, where the level of homophobia and discrimination is much higher. Maybe the experience that you have in China will be helpful as we look at helping people in parts of the country that are not as accepting and not as welcoming.
就是在美国有也有一些其实也还很落后、很保守的地方。那你们的经验也许对那些地方的机构或者activists会有用的。
I think we have time for one last question in the back here.
Thank you very much. I've learned a lot from you. I am a lucky recipient of some of the benefits of the lesbian, gay, bi, transgender movement here in Los Angeles. I live at Triangle Square, which is one of the, it's the housing, first housing for LGBTQ people in the United States. None of this came about without a very powerful movement in the streets for many years. And I think one of the things that we have in common in China and the US is we have a few rich people and many, many people who are struggling. And I'm sure you've noticed the many people in the streets of the United States, which is disgusting. And I would offer this as somewhat of an analysis of the violence. I think it's rooted in capitalism. And I'm really sorry to say that I see China going more and more like the US. I have a question for you. I'm with a socialist political party, the Freedom Socialist Party, and we've been advertising, we have an article in our paper about the many strikes in China. So I know there's workers' uprisings in China, and also women are also fighting back. And I'm wondering if they're connecting with you and if you are connecting with them, because together is the only way that we're going to beat the Trumps, I think, of the world.
And maybe if I can, and I sort of expand on that question, and it's an issue that we have faced here as LGBT activists. How do we ally ourselves with the labor movement? How do we ally ourselves with the women's movement? Because together we have so much power. And is that something that is going on in China today?
我们机构其实除了在去关注同志群体以外，其实我们在关注性工作者的部分。其实性工作者的部分就会跟劳工权益的部分是有关的。所以其实我们再去整个性少数群体的时候，其实我们是会包括LGBT和性工作者和劳工的一些机构会跟他们有一些合作的。
There are some collaboration in the case of my organization because one of our focuses is sex workers, and many of them are not LGBT people. Some of them service the LGBT community. So that is when we collaborate with them, is typically a labor issue. It's about workers' rights protection. So there are, that's an example. So there are some collaboration between various rights organizations.
但其实我们是比较特殊的一个部分，因为其实劳工的劳工权益其实在中国是更敏感的一个话题，因为它其实对于中国政府来讲是比较去关注的一个对象，包括就是可能从整个政策上来讲呢，它是一个比较敏感的。所以其实我们目前我不太知道，就是有一些同志机构是跟一些劳工权益的一些机构是合作的，但是其实我们是因为有性工作者的部分，那包括其实我们。
But generally speaking, labor issues in China is extremely politically sensitive. The Chinese Workers' Union is not a workers' organization, it's a governmental organization. We, because of the sex worker work, have some collaboration with labor unions, but most LGBT people or organizations probably do not. But I think some of them can speak about collaboration with, you know, feminists and so forth.
我也可以说一点。我刚才听你提到有说有无家可归的人，包括我在洛杉矶同志中心也看到有一些无家可归的 LGBT 人，青少年。 但是在中国这个基本上是不会发生的，因为中国的文化它是使得就是父母和对子女的要求或者期待是很高的。如果当他发现自己的孩子是 LGBT 的时候，他不会让他变成无家可归的人，他会为他找一个家。So
I just want to comment. He just want to comment on the homeless issue you were talking about. In China, that does rarely happen. And as we were saying earlier, in the US, for example, fundamental Christian parents might kick their kids out. Where in China, they would do what Mulan has said earlier. They would forcefully keep her home and try to change her. So that's somewhat of a difference.
我在我的家乡曾经碰到过一个拉拉, 他也是一个就是在服务员做 就在酒店做一个服务员，是个体力劳动者。然后呢，当他的父亲知道他是，当他告诉他父亲他是一个拉拉的时候，他的父亲就很快给他，找到了一个，他的父母很快给他找到一个老公，并且默许他的老公去强奸了他。I
know of a lesbian who used to work at a hotel as a service personnel. Her father found out she was a lesbian, so he quickly found a quote-unquote husband for her and encouraged this man to rape her.
当他的女朋友去向中国的很多的同志组织，包括拉拉组织和同志和gay组织去求助的时候呢，我们很多组织也去帮助他。我和另外一个组织的负责人一起，我们去到他的家乡看到他。然后呢，他的家乡，他是一个生活在一个村子里面，并且是一个信回教的村子。
This lesbian reached out to many organizations, so many tried to help. Me and another organization representative went to visit her. She lives in a very rural area who is predominantly Muslim.
当时她是处于被她的丈夫几乎是半监禁一样的状态带着她来见到我们的。然后呢，我们谈到她的问题，但是我们没有能帮助她。
And when she met us, her husband had to chaperone. And so in the end, even though she told us a lot, but we really couldn't do much to help her.
因为他已经结婚了，他们拥有结婚证，并且他是在婚内强奸，也是不算强奸的，而且也没有老公组织或者是其他的像妇联这样的组织能够去实质性给他实质性的帮助，除非他逃走，但是呢，他受到家庭的情感上的压力或者是经济的压力，使他又不能去逃走。Because
they are legally married, and in Chinese law, there is no rape within the marriage. So there will be no government organizations or the legal system that will help her.
So I want to ask Mulan, and this, you'll have the final word tonight. In this country, lesbian organizations often were much more closely associated with the women's movement and women's liberation, as opposed to gay organizations, which were often dominated by men. What is your experience working with, if at all, working with the women's movement in China?
我说中文。其实在中国女权运动和拉拉的一些组织确实有很紧密的联系。
The same thing exists in China. The feminist movement and the lesbian movement are very closely tied in China.
包括有一些关于女权运动的代表性的事件，其实他们那个团队里有大部分人都是 lesbian.
In the last few years, there have been some highly publicized feminist activities, and most of the participants were also lesbians who are interested in feminist issues.
比如是一些关于就业时候的性别歧视的案件，还有就是。 女厕所的一些案件都是由很多 lesbian 来策划的。
For example, there were two very highly publicized cases. One was about gender discrimination in employment. Another was about the inequality of bathroom provisions in public facilities. And most of the participants in both of those demonstrations were actually lesbians.
一些女权主义者，当他们就是倡导女性的性权利的时候，也往往都会就是也一定会提到女同性恋者的权利。And
most of the feminists, when they talk about sexual rights of women, they will also talk about lesbian sexual rights.
所以有很多一些人是通过女权的一些，是通过女权主义，然后了解到了同性恋。So
there are many people who came in contact with feminist thoughts and movements first and through it begin to understand about homosexuality and the LGBT people.
It sounds similar to what we've had in this country as well. So again, I'm sorry we don't have more time tonight, but thank you all for being here tonight. Thank you for your patience as we translated. Thank you to the center and Daryl for your pioneering work. And please join me in thanking our tremendous panelists tonight. Thank you so much for sharing your experiences with us. And in closing, I want to invite you all out into the lobby. We do have a little reception. There'll be opportunities to talk a little bit more with our guests, as well as I think there's some dessert out there too. Good. So, all right. Thank you again for being here tonight.